All right. Go deep. Go deep. Episode 202. I haven't done one like this in a while. This is going to be in podcast format. But I'm going to do a little quick talk. Got some shit to say real quick, and then we're going to get into why I made a podcast. It's going to open your eyes to a little bit more shit. But first, we got to get into some music, as we always do. Get your mind right. Listen to some songs. Tell your girl how much you love her. Tell your mama to stop calling my phone after 7. Yeah, man.
Hey man, this straight shooter man.
How many times?
Hit me 3 times, man. Make sure they chunky. Yeah.
Alright, buddy.
Get the red dog police department. Get your goddamn. 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 Get your goddamn.
Two, the three, the four, them done. Red dog, the three, the four, and they got everybody under the fold, and they ain't gon' leave until they find them kids.
Now, Dirty Bill Clinton fronted me some fold, told me to bring him back eight, and I only brought him 5 and stuck his ass for 3. I think they're clapping the sickest goons on me.
Ain't gon' leave until they find them kids.
Now if Dirty Bill Clinton fronted me some weight, told me keep 2, bring him back 8. I only brought him 5 and stuck his ass for 3. Do you think that clap of the sickest goons on me? See, Martin Hall, that's my claim to fame. It's where I learned my slickest tricks in the dope, the game. Like my face, I call it Lemon Head Delight. When you lick off all the yellow and you sell the white.
The pimpin' be your sports, see, I be being receiver. That nigga the B.I.G. will make believers. Sippin' on Quavo Gold off in the club, drunk his foot. Callin' them hoes bitches and smoking my weed up. When I'm 2 yeah, older now, most legal. Wanted to live the life of Cadillacs and Regals. Fucking around with hoes, bustin' nothing out. That same southern slang, looking for love. Yo,
see, powder get you hype, reefer makes you calm. Cigarettes give you cancer, rules make you dumb. What you niggas know about the dirty side? What you niggas know about the dirty side?
See, never did I think when I got grown that some Pee Wee sacks have been untook this town. Like, life's a bitch. Then you figure out, you really dropped in the dirty side. See, in the 3rd grade, this is what you told. You was bald, you was sold. Now they juice left some heads cracked. I bet you Jed Clampy wanted money back. See, East Atlanta through this roadblock. Tell my this low traffic got to stop. So the big time players all John Freeman wait to find themselves another back street to take. Back day, we was out of control. We didn't understand all, nigga, that money ain't Joe. That's when me and Big Slate took a oath and swear. Never would we talk, never would we tell. So when they pulled up, bump and rock the bell, we took what we wanted and left them quiet as hell. What you niggas know about the dirty side? What you niggas know what dirty side?
Now the Cobras got the boys on the lonely back. Pile of that Miss Ashley ding, they didn't get trapped. Behind the black, the green, the red tent. Dealers breaking, blowing for them wood chips. A lot of faces ain't around, the folks got shot. Scatter mac and cheese while that crystals pop. Been on the ground with breeze, dropping pounds with beef. Eric Neal, the coolest from a century. Mac Towns, strong, school like Charles. Stankin' like them Lanky P, my paw. Pair the homes. Had to feel the creek, shit, just don't sleep. The dirty side.
2, 3, the four, them dirty red dogs done hit the door. They got everybody on their hands and knees. And they ain't gon' leave until they find them kids. See, powder get you hot, reefer makes you cough. Cigarettes give you cancer, rules make you dumb. What you niggas know
the dirty side?
So what you niggas know about the dirty side?
Yeah, the dirty side.
All right. We're back. I hope y'all like that song. So check this out. Let's get into it. So in this Snyder Cut movement, we see a lot of shit go on. We see just the wildest shit. Just the wildest shit. On top of the wildest shit, we see like, it's always like some weird shit going on. It's always some weird type of vibe going on in the Snyder Cut movement. And it's always like a, there's like a lot of, I'm just thinking, think about like in numbers, there's so many of us. There's like a shit ton of cool people that give you the shirt off their back, do everything they can to make this shit work. And there's a shit ton of people that's just got some other shit going on, right? But there's a shit ton of, like, blue checks that just come out of nowhere at any time. And it's usually, like, right after some good news happens. So, I guess we can expect some good news sometime soon. I don't know. But if we're following patterns, the blue checks usually attack one of us right after some good news happened. But I don't know what good news happened recently, but when I just got dissed by a blue check dude. All right. And so my fucking, it's like the same shit like when Film Gob got attacked by homeboys. And, you know, the list probably goes on and on and on. So when we look at our movement, there's, like I was saying, cool people, blah, 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 weird people. But when we talk about this, it's like tribalism, right? So when you're looking at tribalism, there's like a friendly tribalism, like sports games. You know, I can like the Buffalo Bills and somebody else like the New York Jets or Chicago Bears or somebody like that. And we could still be friendly with each other. That's called like friendly tribalism. And then you have, it's a weird version. What we keep wondering, what's this weird thing going on? We keep wondering, like, and this has been like a common theme to go deep. There's always a hidden hand to two forces. Always. There's always, but on the internet, that hidden hand probably is magnified in the tribalism. From one side to another, probably has a few hidden hands in between it. All right. So now you look at that, and of course there will have to be, because the movement is so powerful, as we've seen day in and day out when the blue checks try to attack us. The movement strikes back hard, like we shoot shit up. But could that be manipulated? Yes, it could be manipulated. The fire truck is coming by because he know this is a hot fucking topic. So he knows that shit. So he had to turn up the fucking sirens. I understand. So what you can do on social media, and I'm just learning. I spent the last few years learning this, and I think I'm learning a lot more than I expected, but there's been like a common theme on Go Deep, because I was always trying to prod and find out what else is going on. I always ask my guests that, what else is this going on? Because it's kind of obvious what's going on, but it's kind of obvious, like, if you kind of know what we're good at. So America, we're good at our best export is culture. Our biggest export is like fashion and culture and vibes and, you know, all that shit. What we do becomes the vibe. It becomes the culture. It becomes a fad, the fashion around the whole world. New York is the leader of that. So New York and California, one fashion capital you know, like New York pushes out a lot more than just fashion, but everything, music, LA, movies, but they're both politically connected to the Democratic Party. So their vibe always has to toe the Democrat line. If you get in the Republican line and you start speaking about it, they don't want to talk to you. They don't want to let that out. Like, only a few, like Fox does it, but Fox still has a sneaky, sly Fox vibe also. So I'm not shouting them out. But the vibe, the culture to the world is to not be Republican, not be Democrat. I mean, not be Republican, be a Democrat. And that's pushed because it's pushed out from Chicago, I mean, from New York and LA, both, you know, Democrat states. So when we push that out over the world now thinks, oh, all Republicans are shit. Trump is shit because all of the media circuits that we listen to said that. But the rest of America might be like, yo, Trump pretty fucking cool. But the two states that pushed out the world vibe, they will make it like this. We speak for America. They don't speak for America. They're controlling America with their vibe, with their little magic, their force. So we see all like Jussie Smollett. He goes and does his little thing. And he says somebody in a MAGA hat choked him out, and he had a little fake noose. And Jussie Smollett is connected to, you know, Fox. He plays on the show Empire. He fucking also is connected to the Obamas, Democrats. He's also connected to Michelle Obama. He's done a lot of work, you know, philanthropy work with Michelle Obama. Plus, the dudes that supposedly beat him up were gay African dudes. So we know those dudes are probably connected to Obama. African. There's connections here. There's more connections there than it is to Trump wearing a MAGA hat. But that was a psychological operation. That was a psyop that was done to make the world think MAGA people are fucked up. Republicans are fucked up. But that was done with connections from Hollywood to Washington, D.C. Probably to New York also. Also Chicago. But why would they want that? Why would they want that? Is there groups that can influence the world politically by only influencing certain groups? Yes, it is. This is the whole point of Go Deep. Because this is what we did. We influenced the world that the Snyder Cut was cool. But in that influence, in us influencing the world, we noticed there was people always trying to influence us. Mm-hmm. There's people always trying to influence what we push out. I remember when the merger was going down, 2016 and 17, and Donald Trump was in the middle because Donald Trump had beef with CNN. CNN, who pushes out nothing but Democrat propaganda. Donald Trump had beef with CNN over, it was like a little fake beef though, but that what held up the merger. The merger is what happened with the Snyder Cut. So I remember I said, yo, we need to tweet Donald Trump. No, 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 Peely, you can't do that. No, you can't do that. Why I can't do that, dog? He's our president and he's involved in the merger with AT&T, with this. He's involved in this Snyder Cut shit. No, Peely, don't do that. I can't forbid you, but Zach will hate it if you do that. Okay. damn, what the hell is this? This is some political shit going on. This is some political influence in this shit, 100%. Ben Shapiro tweets released a Snyder cut. No, Ben Shapiro, you can't be in our movement. Why can't Ben Shapiro be in the movement? Because he's a Republican. Not because nothing that he said, because he was a Republican. So then it's like, damn, we're supposed to alienate half or more than half the majority of Americans, because why? I thought we just wanted to come together to see the Snyder Cut. What more is this? So one, you see that, and the smart guy is supposed to instantly know there is some political influence in this bitch. All right. So when you think that, you got to know who a political person would call to influence a movement. In the Black Panthers, when they had their movement popping, how the political people broke them down. They put their cameraman was the CIA and FBI. Their cameraman was the feds. Their girlfriends was the feds. That's what broke them down. So they were influenced to go from a peace, love, and, you know, free lunch movement after school program to now carry around guns and run up in the fucking courthouse with guns. And while they were doing it, they were on camera. So the people on camera was the feds. The people holding the cameras was the feds. So then they put it into the industry, the media, and it made them look bad. But their need to be seen was their downfall. Because their need to have cameramen around them and their need to have clout and blue checks was their downfall. So when you see people coming at you through the blue checks, you know what it is. Because here's how it's done. They give you what you want, but they control what they gave you. And then they control you off a cliff. That's just how it goes. Whether it's done, they can push you through suicide through social media. They can, nothing sprouts organically in the world of culture creation. Culture is created. And it's one of America's biggest exports. It's war, then culture. Probably tech somewhere in here, but it's culture. Culture is up there. And I know you probably don't believe me, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put a white guy in here. And when a white guy says it, then you catch up to what, when you really think what this white guy said, what Peely just said, and the movement, put them shit together, and you're going to know exactly what the tribes are doing, exactly who the tribes are, exactly what the tribes want, and exactly what tribe you should stay away from. Watchmen, you bitch! That's me giving a shout out to the Watchmen. I'm not saying stay away from the Watchmen. You should only want to fuck with the Watchmen. Okay, you bitch.
Using social media to assassinate someone. That sounds crazy.
You could do that sitting at home on your couch in your pajamas.
Before there was anything like an internet or social media, there was still disinformation, right?
Oh, yes. The first office of propaganda was established by the Catholic Church. And you know what? It still exists.
Why do people, are they so surprised that the Russians are interfering in our elections?
The people who actually hold a patent on something called the social credit system is actually Facebook.
As a private company, you can pretty much do anything you want.
But in this space, I'm afraid the battlefield is our own territory, not theirs.
Welcome back to Generally Speaking. Today we have Rand Waltzman from Rand. I like that, Rand from Rand. And we're going to talk about influence. We're going to talk about disinformation. We're going to talk about a bunch of things. So Rand, I'd like to say thanks for joining the show, and let's get right into it. So tell the viewers a little bit about yourself.
Well, I guess the relevant part of this is I was at DARPA. I ran a program called Social Media and Strategic Communications, which was probably well, probably the largest social media program ever funded by the government. It was about $50 million. And, you know, it ended in 2015. So judging by the way things are going, I guess I was a little bit ahead of my time. Unfortunately, you know, I made a statement at one meeting that the program benefited everybody in the world except the United States government, who paid for it. That's really unfortunate. Since the U.S. government no part of the government has really chosen to take advantage of these techniques. So, but my interest in this actually goes back a long way. I mean, the original title of my PhD thesis, well, so my PhD is in computer science, and I was an AI person by training. And the original title of my thesis in the early 80s was The Automatic Generation of Plausible Disinformation. So my interest in this.
The original bot generator.
Yes. So, well, it was more like a tool, an information tool. You know, I had this whole concept of disinformation management systems. I thought information management, you know, that's limited interest, but disinformation management systems, now that's really the ticket. So I had this whole theory, as opposed to information theory, I had a whole idea of disinformation theory worked out. So I was out there pretty early. So yeah, so my interest in this goes back a long way.
So it sounds like you were one of those kids that really got into the lies.
Oh yeah.
So you've told me before that you were advising on some television shows, and yes. One of the things you talked about was using social media to assassinate someone. That sounds crazy, but can you talk us through that?
Oh sure. It was a show called Homeland. And I was giving some little advice on social media there. In fact, I guess it was because of me that they introduced the whole concept of social media into the show at all. So one of the meetings, early meetings I had with those guys, I told them, I said, look, you can do lots of interesting things with social media, like assassinating people. I said, like physically assassinating. And they said, well, you know, they looked at me in shock. They said, well, no, how could that possibly work? So I explained it. And I said, it's a variation on the old Mission Impossible story. So you remember Mission Impossible, the TV show, they would get an assignment to assassinate some guy, and they would have to physically infiltrate his organization, and then they convinced his colleagues that he had somehow ratted them out or turned on them or done something to them, so that they would conveniently go and then put a bullet in the guy's head, and then the Mission Impossible team, then they had to sneak away. They had vans waiting for them. They were always in costume, so it was always a big complicated thing. So I explained to these guys today, you can do that so much easier. You could do that sitting at home on your couch in your pajamas. No problem at all. All you have to do is take your target. You do a profile of your target. See what it is, you know, what it is they're interested in, what's their platforms and positions. And then you go out in the space and you locate a small group of sort of real pathological nutcases, really violent, whose views are diametrically opposed to this guy. They may never have even heard of him, but that you can fix that. So then the idea is you start spreading rumors that are designed to get exactly to those people. And they get so incensed, you push them over that. You know, that this guy either said something or did something, which he may never have done or said, doesn't matter. But it's plausible, it's consistent with his beliefs if they looked him up and know anything about him. So then they get so angry that you push, that they go over and conveniently put a bullet in the guy's head or blow him up or whatever. And you didn't have to get off, you didn't even have to get out of your pajamas to do the whole thing. So it's great. Often many, many fantastic possibilities.
So that's fiction.
That was fiction, yes. And they actually did that in the show.
But there are actual elements of disinformation that predate social media, right?
Oh, yes.
And that's one of the things that you're an expert on, kind of the evolution of disinformation. So, yes. You know, before there was anything like an internet or social media, there was still disinformation, right?
Oh, yes. This is a long and dishonorable tradition, I can say. I mean, it goes, I mean, in this, I think it was in the 17th century that the first office of propaganda, it was actually called the Office of Propaganda, was established by the Catholic Church. I think it was Pope Gregory, I don't remember, the 15th or something. It was like a 1630, I think, if I remember the dates right, around that time frame. And it was called the Office of Propaganda. And you know what? It still exists. The office still
really?
Yes, a few years ago, they have their own web pages. If you go to the Vatican's web pages, I mean, you can read the whole history of the Office of Propaganda, you know, and so that was really sort of the first official, you know, official on paper start of the whole business. It's even then it was old news, I mean, right? So, but the modern version of disinformation goes back certainly to the beginning of the last century. So, for example, one of the greatest pieces of disinformation ever perpetrated in modern times was something called the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. And it was all about Jewish conspiracy theories to take over the world and everything else. And it was created by a guy named Rashkovsky, who was the head of the Paris office of the Okhrana, which was the Tsarist secret police. This was around 1900. So, you know, this guy was great. He did all kinds of tricks like that. I mean, it was a whole big thing with him. So, you know, the KGB, they just inherited the Okhrana, the Tsarist playbooks. And then when the KGB fell apart, the modern Russians just inherited the KGB's playbooks. So there's a long tradition of doing this kind of work there. And in fact, in the Soviet Union, the KGB, I mean, they had always been involved in this kind of work, but they actually formed the first official office of what was called Department D of the first chief directorate of the KGB, which was the first chief directorate was the foreign section. Department D was created in the early 50s, and the D stood for Desinformatia, which in Russian is disinformation, of course. And that department was elevated to a service, which is a higher level organization, Service A, at the end of the 60s. And so A stood for, oddly enough, the initials for active measures are the same in Russian, AM. In Russian, it's Aktivne Meroprayatchne. So it's the same AM. And it was elevated to a service. So yeah, so these things go back long, long way.
So today, when you look at what's going on both internationally, and I know you're really focused on Russia. Have you started to look at the Chinese Communist Party at all?
Oh, yeah.
Domestically, like how would you go about describing the interplay between active measures coming from Russia, coming from China, and then just the political parties here in the United States using some of the same techniques, I would believe, against each other? You know, how does it all work together in your mind?
Well, you know, people have different approach. I mean, I've always been into the Chinese for a long time. I mean, I haven't only focused on Russia because I think the Chinese, you know, these are really serious players. They do a great job. They're well organized. They have a slightly different, or have had up to now, I would say, quite a different philosophy than the Russians on how to do this kind of work. They've been, you know, the early times they were focused really more on their own populations. I mean, look, after all, if you were sitting on top of 1.4 billion people, wouldn't you be scared? I mean, I'd be worried. I'd want to make sure I had things under control. So, I mean, I get that. I understand that. So, yeah, but their techniques have gone back a long way. One of the greatest ideas I think that they've implemented is this whole idea of the social credit scoring system. Now, what's interesting about the social credit scoring system is that the people who actually hold a patent on something called the social credit system is actually Facebook. And Facebook took the patent over from Friendster, which was an old social media company from the early 2000s. And in 2006, I think it was, they filed a patent on the social credit system, but it wasn't granted. And then in 2011 or 12, something like that, Facebook took over the patent and saw it through to completion. The patent was granted in 2015. So Facebook actually has the patent on the social credit system. But the Chinese are the people who really implemented it. I mean, serious big time. I mean, they really got it. And the fantastic thing about it is the idea of crowdsourcing crowd control. I mean, it's ingenious, really. They took the idea way beyond what the Friendster guy had in mind. So crowdsourcing crowd control, you know, especially when you have a crowd that size, it's actually a brilliant idea. So that's only one thing they do. But the thing about the Chinese is that their approach is actually full spectrum across all of branches of government. And they attempt to coordinate it, I mean, really coordinate all of their activities across all types of influence activities, you know, centrally. So while they try to do central control, they also have some kind of distributed implementation. So sometimes some of the elements work across purposes against each other, and sometimes they trip themselves up. But generally speaking, I mean, they're doing a fine job.
I like that. You threw in the generally speaking, so that's great.
Yes.
Generally speaking. Promoted my show in the midst of the show. That's great.
Absolutely.
So this is what I've contended for a long time, is that we invented all these tools And to your point about DARPA, we've spent a lot of money trying to understand how to use technology to do disinformation. Of course, Facebook, Amazon, Google are very good at using technology to influence people to buy more shoes, for example. But then what the Chinese Communist Party did was take those tools and then update them and make them useful for controlling the population. I like the point that you made about crowdsourcing crowd control, because that's exactly what they do. They have their 50 Cent Army that is basically there to not stifle dissent, only stifle viral dissent, right? So as soon as it hits a certain level, then they start to basically squelch it. So, and when you're looking at, like, if you were going to, and certainly you've worked on this at DARPA, but what have you recommended to the government? Because I know this is a hard problem in terms of democracies. How do you prevent this kind of stuff from undermining our principles, our values, our society, our democracy, our institutions? What have you recommended? And has any of those recommendations ever been adopted? Or is it just something where you think that we haven't recognized the threat to America of these things?
Well, so the first problem is that, I mean, at this point, you know, pointing the fingers to foreign influence, it's almost a form of misdirection, because I would say that by now, the domestically originated threat is probably even bigger than the foreign one. I mean, think about it, right? How is it, you know, people heard, you know, talk a lot about the $100,000 that the Russians might have spent on Facebook ads, you know, on 2016 elections, but you hardly ever hear anybody talk about the $100 million that the Russians spent on American public relations firms. Hiring them to push their agenda. Ketchum Public Relations is a great example. The story came out in 2015 that the Russians had invested at least $50 million on their books. I mean, to push their agenda.
So things like, you're talking like Cambridge Analytica, stuff like that. Is that what you're referring to? Companies that basically use these databases or use these platforms to you know, they sell out the ability to both understand but also influence the members?
Yeah, sure, they're mercenaries. I mean, these guys, I mean, but think about it, right? How would you ever compare a person's, you know, some guy sitting at the Internet Research Agency in St. Petersburg with a guy sitting in Washington, D.C., who works for Ketchum or some other public relations organization like that? How, you can't compare those people. The guy in D.C. would beat the pants off the Russian guy any day.
Because he knows the people, he knows the society, yes. Knows the customs.
Yeah, not only that, but he probably came from the Hill, okay, to start with. So he's got all the connections. I mean, at least for that part of their business. He's got all the connections. They can pick up a phone, they can get a reporter to hold a story. They can do all sorts of things. You know, they know the people intimately who are involved.
So it's an intersection of the ability to have these financial transactions with the expertise that goes into using data for influence. Is that what you're saying?
Sure.
The combination of the two.
Yes.
Makes a lot of sense.
Plus the fact that, you know, unlike the government, they don't have any restrictions. You know, they don't have to worry about human subject protection. They don't have to worry about privacy laws or anything else.
Right?
What's that?
As a private company, you can pretty much do anything you want.
Pretty much.
In this space.
Yep. Pretty much.
So getting back to, you know, so basically it sounds like the number one policy recommendation that you would have is stop allowing for state actors to pay companies like, now you mentioned Ketchum, like what are the top companies that you would say in the country that utilize these types of technologies and techniques to influence on behalf of their clients?
Well, I mean, most of the big, all the big PR companies, I mean, you know, it's all of them, basically. They'll tell you, these are, I mean, they're mercenaries. They're hired guns. You pay them to promote an idea, they promote it. I mean, I had a friend, I'll give you an example. I had a friend who worked at some company, one of these companies, a smaller one. And he was asked by another company who had just gotten a big client. This is in the U.S. now. This is not overseas. Big client. And this guy said, well, okay, well, who's the client? Said, well, we can't tell you till you're ready to sign on the dotted line. So they negotiated, okay, fine. Now the guy's ready to sign up. And he said, okay, well, tell me who the client is. Well, the client turns out, without naming any names, to be a really bad guy in another country. that in the leadership of another country. So this friend of mine said, yeah, you know what? That's where I draw the line. I'm not doing that. But the company that was trying to hire him had no issues with it whatsoever.
Right. They had no compunction about, you know, yeah. It's just money, right?
Yeah, it's a business. That's one of our biggest exports has been this. It's been influence peddling as a business.
That's actually quite frightening.
Yes. And we're really good at it, at least as long as you're outside the government. The U.S. government is worthless, but the private sector is spectacular.
So people would take what you just said and they're like, how can the U.S. government with all its money and all its power be useless in this area? And you and I both know it's because in a lot of respects, it's because of our laws and our system and our democracy and our respect for privacy and individual prerogative. But can you kind of elaborate on, you know, why the government stinks so bad when it comes to protecting Americans from influence?
Well, so you have to realize, right, that, you know, it's not only these you know, foreign actors who are employing these countries, it's also U.S. politicians, U.S. politicians, U.S. corporations. Basically, everybody's using the same kind of guys. So whose advantage is it to shut them down? I mean, our elected officials, they're not going to gain anything. They're not going to do anything because they all use the same people. So, I mean, that's kind of where the mess that we're in, right? So, I mean, it's not any elected politicians to any elected politician's advantage to actually do anything about the problems. I mean, they can hide behind privacy laws and they can hide behind bad optics and they can hide behind all kinds of things. But at the end of the day, it's not to their advantage to actually do anything proactive about the problem. So, but the other thing is even so, you know, you go back to comparing with the Chinese. One of the things about the Chinese is that the Chinese have an actual message that they're trying to put out. You know, their messaging is clear. It's clear and it's consistent across the government. So, and they've built up this enormous machinery to put the message out. Now, from our side, what's the message? There is no message, actually. So even if we had the machinery, what are you going to say? You know, it's like somebody introduced me to somebody one time. And said, hey, look, this guy speaks 8 languages. And the other guy said, okay, but does he have anything to say?
Good point.
Right?
Good point.
So even if we had the machinery, we have nothing to say, really.
We used to have the U.S. Information Agency that was disbanded in 1999, which was focused on public diplomacy. And did that for the U.S. government during the Cold War, but we got rid of it. And now, if you look at the Agency for Global Media, Voice of America, Radio Free Asia, Radio Free Europe, they're conflicted because on the one hand, they say, well, we have to adhere to journalistic standards. And on the other hand, we have to promote U.S. principles and values. And so the first one says that while we're promoting U.S. principles and values, we also have to give Tehran, Beijing, Pyongyang, and Moscow equal airtime because that's journalistic, not prerogative, but you know what I'm saying. Yep. That's journalistic standards. You're upholding journalistic standards if you have a balanced view. But what we're talking about here is a view of the U.S. government versus a totalitarian regime, and that we should give the totalitarian regime equal airtime to our own government. This is the lunacy upon which our government, you know, rests its you know, voice, right?
Well, the problem is it doesn't have a voice.
Right.
I mean, that's at the end of the day, that's the real problem.
And what voice it has is drowned out by all of these countries that do have a voice. And really, when you get right down to our national security strategy, it's a recognition that, number one, we don't have a voice. Number two, we're not approaching these challenges in ways that the Chinese Communist Party and the Russians are, which are primarily to use relationships and disinformation to create geopolitical advantage. And we, on the other hand, are running around having these wars all over the place, spending trillions of dollars. And as you know, and I know, they're spending very little money, but getting a lot more oomph at the United Nations, at the WTO, at the World Bank, at the IMF, at the World Health Organization. So again, I ask you, you know, what recommendations have you made? And then what have, you know, because I've known you a while now, and you've always had great understanding of the problem and great recommendations. But I'm concerned because that's never translated into more of a recognition within, you know, our own foreign policy making process that we need to do something about it. What when you talk to people about this, is it just, do they give you platitudes, or how do you, you know, how do they respond to you generally?
Well, generally, like when I was at DARPA, I was going around in the government talking to all sorts of people. And basically, you know, they just didn't want to hear it. Well, that's, you know, we can't do anything about it. I mean, people hide behind authorities issues. They hide behind privacy laws. They hide behind all kinds of things. Any excuse not to do anything about the problem. And so, you know, why did they disband the U.S. Information Agency? You know, I was at a meeting. So, you know, there used to be something called the Active Measures Working Group, okay, which was disbanded just around the time of, just right after the dissolution of the Soviet Union. And the purpose of the Active Measures Working Group was to actually counter Soviet active measures. And, you know,
right?
Which never stopped. In fact,
why do people, are they so surprised that the Russians are interfering in our elections? This is what they do.
Yes, it's unbelievable. So how is it? I was at a guy in England, this guy Peter Pomerantsev, they wrote a report, him and a couple other guys, about Russian news influence operations. So this was a few years back, and I was at the coming out party for this report, and a friend of mine who was one of the last members of the Active Measures Working Group, as a matter of fact, and the guy who wrote the final report. The great Todd Leventhal, one of the great unsung heroes of the State Department. And if you want a spectacular guest on your show, you should get him.
Take a note.
Yes. I'll be happy to send you his contact information. But you know, he and I were talking to a woman, a very senior official in the State Department. And I asked her, I said, whatever possessed you to disband the Active Measures Working Group? And she looked me right in the eye with Todd standing there right next to me. And she said, well, the Cold War was over. It wasn't necessary anymore. Wow. Spectacular answer. I said, so my response to that was, I said, well, was that a view that was widely held among the senior leadership in the State Department? She says, oh, yes. I said, you know what? That explains plenty.
That explains everything.
Yeah. I didn't even know how could I respond to that?
Okay. So here's the deal. I'm going to make you Secretary of Defense, and I'm going to give you just to help you a bit, I'm going to give you a few nuclear weapons, you know, so you'll have those. Then you tell me how much money I need to give you so that you can play a little bit better. Because right now I'm giving you $800 billion. What if I'm Trump and I say, okay, I've been giving you $800 billion and we're spending this money and I'm not getting anything out of it. Everybody's going with the Chinese and they won't listen to us. You know, if I gave you some money, you know, how much of that $800 billion could I get back? And then you could just help me begin to shape the world in ways using all these tools, because globalization's not going away. The internet's not going away. You know, AI, you're an AI expert. Okay, how much money would it cost me, and what would, you know, how would that look?
Well, so the thing of it is, it isn't really so much about the money, because it doesn't take that much money. And that is evidenced by the fact that I can
build roads and bridges.
Yes, but right, sure, you could do that. But I mean, but the basic information part of it, it is not that expensive. And that's why you see all these guys are doing this for a song, basically. So it doesn't take much. What it really takes, it takes a complete change in mentality. And that's a lot harder. I mean, it's easier for somebody to throw money at the problem. It's a lot harder for somebody to actually change the attitude. And that's right. Where the biggest problem lies at the moment. So even as Secretary of Defense, it isn't sufficient because, I mean, okay, you can deal with one small piece of the problem, but you can't deal comprehensively with the problem. I mean, what the Chinese have understood is that it has to be a whole of government type of approach. So the entire government has to be involved. It cannot be one branch of any the government by itself. That doesn't work. So if you're going to actually message effectively, so messaging is, you know, like, it's there's a sort of a hierarchy of it, right? So at the very top, you have to have, you know, what's your key message? So the Chinese, part of their key message is, look, we're the good guys. We're here to help. If you just listen to us and you let us help you, we're going to help you out. You know, that's it, right? Where everybody should play nice. It's a win-win for everybody. I mean, that's essentially what their top-level message is. And then they do everything they can, you know, spreading all down the hierarchy to get that message out. So the first thing you actually really need to do is to create an organization which actually can represent the government as a whole, I mean, accurately, and that everybody will cooperate with, you know, which some direction can be set and then implemented down the tree. So that's really the biggest thing that needs to be done. And the whole authorities issue needs to be fixed. There's only right now, there is one person in the entire United States government that doesn't need a presidential finding to put out any rubbish that comes into his head out into social media. Only one person. Well, guess who? The president doesn't need a presidential finding. He does what he can do what he wants, say what he wants, and there's nobody to do anything about it. But if you're anybody else in the government and you try to do the similar kind of thing, boy, they'll come down on you like a ton of bricks.
So my recommendation then is to basically put you in the White House next to the president, help him design his information campaign, and just let him use that platform.
Well, it has to be something beyond any individual office or any individual.
Yeah, yeah.
It has to be something
government approach.
Yes, and it has to also be staying power. It has to. Regardless of outcomes of elections, it has to be able to continue ongoing. It has to have continuity.
Who do you think today, in government, at a high level, understands the things that you're talking about? Who would you say that really gets this idea that, using information and particularly disinformation from our adversaries and understanding that and protecting the country and then using it on behalf of the national interest, who do you think gets that? Because I don't find a lot of people in national security policy making circles that even understand what you're talking about.
No, I don't know. There isn't any. I mean, when I was at DARPA and I had to give briefings on the Hill, which I had to do now and then, I mean, I always walked away in tears because the lack of understanding was like phenomenal. I was so sad and so really horrifying. I mean, these guys, they're completely clueless. I don't know.
So Elbridge Colby, who wrote the current defense strategy, national defense strategy, just came out with an article in Foreign Affairs that said that the Chinese Communist Party's approach is not ideological. And in fact, if we consider it to be ideological, that we're actually creating danger for ourselves. And I looked at that, I'm like, you don't understand the Chinese Communist Party. Their entire campaign is based on control of the narrative and controlling of the way that they are viewed. And if that's not ideological, I don't know. I'm not sure what is.
When people like that use the word ideology, they're talking about some like a philosophy, some kind of overall philosophy. But just saying we're in control, we're gonna manage things the way we think they should be managed. I don't know if I would call that an ideology. I mean, that's just good business. That's just business.
When you make those kinds of claims, that your understanding of the problem, in my mind, is diminished because you don't realize that we believe in the West that war is politics by other means.
Yeah.
Chinese believe that politics is war by other means.
Absolutely.
The whole thing is political.
Yes.
So why would you risk combat when you can convince your adversary that their own system is flawed? I mean, this is the art of warfare.
Well, so, I don't know that you're going to convince them that their system is flawed, but, this is part of the issue with the Defense Department. So, traditionally, a battlefield is where the fighting happens. And the battlefields are, preferably on foreign territory. But in this space, I'm afraid that the battlefield is our own territory, not theirs.
Right.
I mean, what they do with their population is their problem. What they're doing with our population or what we're doing with our own population, that's our problem, right? So the problem is that the real battlefield where the battle is raging is right here in our own backyard. So to say to the Defense Department, for example, that, you can only do operations on foreign soil I don't understand that. If an actual physical army invaded the United States, are you going to say we can only act on the foreign soil. So, sorry, we can't help you.
Do what you want.
Right. It's not our problem. We're only authorized to work on foreign territory. Is that helpful? Would that actually happen? I hope not. But
you and I see things very much the same way. And I really have enjoyed having you on, generally speaking. I always enjoy talking to you because I feel like I have found a kindred spirit in understanding warfare in the way that I should have understood it from the very beginning. But I was always taught you know, that putting a bomb on somebody's head is far more effective than getting them to, you know, do something to their own self. So it's been a tremendous honor of mine to get to know you and learn from you. So I really thank you for coming on generally speaking. And we're going to have you on again because there's so much more to cover in this and you really understand it.
Well, I thank you so much for having me. It was great. And I look forward to coming back again. And I wish you great success with the podcast.
Thank you, Rand.